provides a layer in between your applications and hardware. It's called the kernel. Okay. Now, resource management, that's another job which operating system does. Most of you will know, if will be very familiar, you'll be running more than one application on your computers. Like, you'll be having a Word document open somewhere, you'll be having a browser in another window. But did you notice that there's only one CPU in the computer? There's either one CPU, maybe you have one or two cores on your computer. So how does a computer manage to juggle all these applications running simultaneously? This is actually done by the operating system. What the operating system does is, it gives a small amount of time for each application. So suppose you have your browser and your Word document. It runs the Word document for a small slice of time, and then quickly switches to your browser. And it does this really quick. So you get the illusion that your computer is running many applications simultaneously. Okay, so this is called multitasking. The operating system actually manages this whole thing. Another thing is, you have when you have many applications running on your computer, all these applications are sharing the same main memory. So you have your RAM. Okay, so all these programs are sharing RAM. Now, how do you prevent one program from writing into the RAM of another program? So this is what the operating system does. The operating system provides memory protection. So it protects each, so you have one program that's using a piece of memory and another program. The operating system prevents them from stepping on each other's memory locations. Okay? And most of your computers have one hard disk, and you have all these applications accessing that hard disk. Now, it's the OS, again, that mediates this access. Okay? The OS takes care of, so your first program is asking for this data, the other one is asking for another data. So it's the OS that manages, it takes care of coordinating these programs so that they don't write on each other's data. Okay. Now, standardized interface. Now, earlier I was talking about how your program would talk to the operating system, and how the operating system in turn would take care of doing the hardware specific part of your program. For example, suppose your program needed to open a file. Your program would call the open system call. Okay, it will call a function called open, and you need to pass some parameters like the name of the file and how would you like to open it, whether in read mode or write mode. And then once you call this open function, it's the operating system that actually talks to the hardware, to the hard disk, and pulls that file from the memory. Okay, so the operating system knows exactly how to talk to the hardware. Your application, so the only way your application interacts with the computer, with the operating system, is through some specific functions which are provided by the operating system, and these are called system calls. Okay, these are called system calls. So every operating system provides a bunch of system calls that can do a variety of things, like read files, send some data on the network, do something like that. So this is the only way an application, so you're a program, you're writing a program, the only way you can request some service from the computer is through these system calls. Now, if you standardize, okay, now this system calls, like suppose we are talking about open system call, you need to provide a file name and you need to provide a mode how to open the file. Now, different operating systems, we have a bunch of operating systems, Windows, Linux, okay, we have a lot of operating systems. Now, if we would standardize this system call, suppose we told that if you want to call open, you would call the name of the function for opening a file is open, and the first parameter should be the name of the file, the second parameter should be the mode. So if we fix the syntax, or if we fix how if you fix the details of how the application calls its system calls, suppose you have two operating systems. Okay, and both of them support this open system call with the same parameters and the same order. Now, when you are a programmer, you don't need to rewrite your program to use it on a new operating system, because the operating system speaks the same language as the application. So the application knows, okay, I'm going to use the open system call and pass these two parameters and the file will be open. So in Unix, what we do is we standardize this API. An API is an application program interface, so this set of system calls with which the application talks to the operating system is standardized. Okay, so there's a list that says, okay, this is the open call, the first parameter is this, the second parameter is that. This is standardized. So what this means is that you can move your program from one system to another without modifying it, because your program talks to application using one specified language. Now your hardware can change. Your hardware can change underneath, but it doesn't change your program. Okay, so these are the advantages of having an operating system. And this is called abstraction. What you're doing is you're moving away from the hardware so that your programmer doesn't need to know all the details. So coming to Unix and Linux. So Unix was an operating system that was written in the late 60s, early 70s. Okay. Unix was originally written in a very low level language called assembly language. Okay. Assembly language is like a very, it's a language that's just above binary. Okay. So Unix was, a few years later, Unix was written in the C programming language. Okay. So this was around the same time, so Unix had a unique design. And it was developed at AT&T Bell Labs. So Unix, once Unix came, after it became popular, several variants, okay, the source code of Unix was available, okay, under license from AT&T. AT&T released the source code under license. And using this Unix, many variants of Unix developed. So you have BSD Unix and HP Unix and many Unixes. The thing was that they shared a similar design, but some of them kind of diverged and become really different. So, as Unix developed, it became obvious that someone needed to standardize what Unix meant. For example, there were companies releasing very different operating systems and calling them Unix. So eventually, as Unix developed, we had so many variants that many Unix vendors got together and developed a standard called POSIX. Okay, it's IEEE. The IEEE developed a standard called POSIX. So what POSIX does, it tells how your Unix system is going to behave. What are the system calls? We were talking about system calls earlier. So Unix, this standard tells you what are the system calls, how you call those, how you use those system calls, and how basically a Unix system should behave. So once the standard came, every company that wanted to create a new Unix would try to make their Unix compatible with the standard. Now, as long as a Unix system is compatible with the standard, it's good for the programmer, because the programmer doesn't need to change his program. Remember the system calls? So as long as you keep the system calls the same, your program can run on an HP Unix system or AT&T Unix, and you wouldn't have to change it. So that's the POSIX standard. So the POSIX standard evolved over the years. Okay, and finally, right now what we have is the POSIX standard. The POSIX name has changed. Right now it's called the Single Unix Specification. Okay, and right now even when, suppose any company wants to develop a new version of Unix, they would refer to the Single Unix Specification if they want to know how the system would behave. Okay, so the name of system calls, how, and even the commands. So how a command should behave. Okay, this is all specified in the standard. Now coming to Linux, in 1983, Richard Stallman, okay, of the Free Software Foundation, started a project called GNU. Okay, GNU. GNU, it was a project that he wanted to create a new operating system which behaved like Unix. Okay, Unix compatible operating system, but it was going to be free. Okay, and by free we don't mean free in cost. Okay, what free software means is this software is governed by a special license. Okay, so normally you buy software like Windows or MATLAB. What is the license? The license is you pay money, you get the software, and you're not allowed to redistribute that software to anybody, and you don't get the source code. Okay, so this program is written in some language like C. You don't get the source code. You're not allowed. They don't sell that to you. But what does free software mean? Free software means that the free software license says that whenever you create a piece of software and license it under a free software license, you have to provide the source code along with it. Okay? So suppose a person gets your program, maybe he can buy it also from you, but you have to provide him with the source code. Plus, this person was allowed to modify, okay? So the person is allowed to modify the source code and redistribute it. So this license tells that I can get source code from someone, I can change the source code around, change it for my use, and I can redistribute it, I can even resell it. But whenever I distribute the new code, I cannot change the license. Okay, so this license tells you that you create a code which is free, you have to release it as free software, and the person who gets it, who modifies it, he is also obliged to release it again as free software. Okay? So now there are several licenses around which are which can be called free software. So there's a BSD license, a GPL license. Okay, there are different licenses. Slightly, they vary in different details, but the basic thing is the same. You're allowed to modify and redistribute programs. Okay. So in 1991, Linus Torvalds, he started a small hobby project, developing a small kernel. Okay. He called it Linux, and his project was aiming for POSIX compliance at that time. So at that time, the POSIX standard was there. He wanted his operating system to be compliant with the POSIX standard. And he released his code as GPL. GPL is a GNU public license. So that's a free software license. So eventually Linux got popular, and because of its easy availability and quick development times, you see that everybody's using Linux nowadays, especially in the server market. Now we'll get to some Unix terminology. Okay, some getting down to Unix. Now Unix is a multi-user operating system. So you can have Unix installed in a computer, you can have more than one user using it. So the user would log in with their ID and some password, and then they would be using the system under their username. So how does Unix enforce this user thing? So in a Unix system, you can define a bunch of users and groups. Okay, so you can say that there's a user 1 and user 2, and you can give them names. Okay, and you can even set, you can group users into sets called groups. Okay, so you can have user 1, user 2, user 3 in group 1, and you can have user 2 and 3 in another group. Okay, so you can have groups like that. So users and groups. Now every file on a hard disk, suppose you have files on your hard disk, every file in a Unix system has a group ownership and a user ownership. So every file is owned. It's owned by some user. Okay, so every user owns some files. And what this means is that, suppose you are user one. You have a bunch of files which are owned by you. This means that you can set permissions on that files. So you can say that, okay, my files will not be readable by user two. Or this particular file should be visible to all users. Or you can say that one group of files should be visible to users of this group. Okay, so those are called file permissions. Now, Unix allows you to own files and set these permissions on those files. Okay. Now, how does every file has a user and group ID associated with it? So usually names in Unix are mapped to IDs. So you suppose user one is a mapped to ID number 5. Okay, and group is mapped to group one is mapped to ID number 12. Okay, so there's a group ID and a user ID. Now on Unix system, there's a special user. There's a special user called root. Okay, root. This user has a ID 0, group ID 0, and user ID 0. Now this root user has unlimited permissions. Okay, so the root user can modify, he can delete any file that belongs to any other user. Okay, so why do we have this? So this root user is somewhat like the administrator account on your Windows systems. Okay, so it allows you to change settings. For example, most of the settings in a computer, like the network settings, okay, settings that are related to hardware, are stored in files in Unix. So only the root user has permission to change the content of these files. Because suppose you edit one of these files, it's going to actually affect how the computer is working. Okay, so this root user has access to all these files so that he can change settings for the computer. Now, because the root user, suppose you have a computer which has a Unix installed on it, generally you need to be cautious when you use the root account. Because if you accidentally issue a command that deletes all files, because you have permissions to delete all files, it's going to wipe out your entire hard disk. But suppose you are a regular user, you log in as user one, okay, and you issue a command to delete all files, you're going to delete only your files because you don't have permissions. You don't have permission to remove files of other people. Okay, so that's how Unix protects user accounts. Okay, so every user has permissions. So no user can actually affect another user's files. And more importantly, he can't affect the stability of the system. So a user does not have permissions to modify important files which tell how the computer is running. Okay. So now we're going to talk about some Unix terminology, some some words which are used when you talk, when you're discussing UNIX. So what's a process? Okay, so you have you have programs. You write programs in some language like C or Fortran. Okay, you compile it. Once you compile it, you get an executable file. Okay, the executable file is what you run. So on Windows, you maybe double click it. On Linux, you'll probably type the name of that command and run it. So that's a program which is sitting on a hard disk, the executable code. Okay, so once you run a program, what the operating system does is going to read that file. Okay, it's going to copy. It's going to copy all or part of that file into main memory. Okay, that's RAM. It's going to copy it into RAM, and then it's going to tell the CPU to go and execute that code which is in the RAM. Okay. Now, once you copy files into memory and tell the CPU that okay, start executing that code. Now that program becomes a process. Okay. In Unix, it's called a process. So, a process is a program which has been loaded into memory and it's ready to run. It's either ready to run or it's running. Now in Unix, every process has a process ID associated with it so that you can perform some operations and so you can keep track of your running program by looking at process IDs. Okay, so there are three states in which a program can be running, stopped, or sleeping. So we'll get to that later. It's all operating system specifics. Now I'll talk about files. Now, when you talk about files, you usually think of a file which sits on a hard disk, right? Something you save on a floppy or a CD. Those are files. Now, in Unix, a file is a little more general. Okay? Now, you have a process. We talked about process earlier. So a process can open a number of files, okay, for reading and writing. So a process can open a file in the hard disk for reading the data from it. Okay? So this is these files. Now, in Unix, a file doesn't need to really exist on a hard disk physically. Okay? So there are, in Unix, in the Unix design, even device files, okay, there are things called device files. For example, think of your modem. Okay, you have a modem which sends data over the telephone line. Okay, now in Unix, in Windows, you might have noticed there's a COM1 and a COM2 special device for your modems. Okay, in Unix, it's not like that. It's just a file. There's a file called /dev/tpys0. Okay, it's a file. It's a file, but that file doesn't really exist on the hard disk. Now what the file does is, if you write to that file or you read from that file, you're actually talking to the modem. Okay. So if you want to send data to the network, you just write to this file. You just write to this file, and automatically the file takes care of sending your data to the modem. So this data is never really stored on a hard disk. So this file is really generated by the operating system. The operating system kind of shows the application that here there's a file, but when you actually write or read from this file, it's talking to the device. It's talking to the modem. Okay. So this is part of the design of the Unix operating system. So what it does is, it displays devices like modems or hard disks. It displays them as though they are files. Okay, so it's like everything is a file. Okay, in Unix. So it's more general because files doesn't need to exist on a hard disk. Now, whenever you start a process, okay, suppose you're running a program, or you wrote a program and you're running it. As soon as the program starts, there are three files which are always open by default, okay, by a process. Okay, this is called the standard input, the standard output, and the standard error. Okay, three files. So these files don't exist on a hard disk again. They're just special files. Now, whenever a program which you wrote writes to the standard output, okay, by default, your standard output is connected to your screen. So whenever a program writes some data into the standard output file, it comes on your screen. And it's the same for the standard error. By default, whenever you write data to a standard error file, the output comes on the screen. Now the standard input, you can't write to that. The standard input is for reading only. Okay? And by default, your standard input is connected to your keyboard. So whenever you enter something on the keyboard, that data is sent to the standard input of your file. So suppose you have a program that asks you to enter a number, okay, and you're entering a number and you press enter. That number is written into the standard input of that file, of that program, the process. So the process reads the standard input and it's going to get what you type on the keyboard. So these three are important when we talk about shell scripting in the next class. Okay. Directory layout. Now, how are files arranged? Now we're talking about physical files. Okay. Physical files are generally files. Now, how are files arranged in a UNIX operating? Now, those of you who are familiar with Windows, you know that there's a C drive and a D drive, okay? There are not drives in UNIX, okay? There's only one single hierarchical tree, okay? So every file on a UNIX system, every file is always within a directory, okay? So you might call it folders. So every file is always within a directory. And you have a hierarchical directory structure. What that means is that you have this structure like this. This is the slash directory, and then you have the subdirectories within it, okay? And these can have subdirectories within them also. So every directory in UNIX is rooted, okay? It begins from this root directory. So there are no drives, everything starts from slash. Okay, this root directory is called slash, okay? Backslash. I'm sorry, forward slash. So that's the opposite as a Windows, okay? So in Windows you use a backslash for separating directories. In Unix, it's opposite, okay? Forward slash. So what's a path name? Now suppose you need to specify a particular file. Suppose you need to specify the location of a file in your file system, okay? This whole thing is called a file system. So you want to specify the location of a file on the file system. You start like this. You start with a slash. Okay, the slash is the root directory. Top, and then you specify each directory and separate them by slashes. Okay, that means within the root directory you have the home subdirectory and the user subdirectory within the home. Okay, and this is the name of the file. So this kind of thing is called a path name. Okay, it kind of tells you how to reach a file in an operating system. Okay, in your file system you have a file. You want to know how to reach that file. This gives you the path. Okay, of how to reach that file. Now, in Unix, the separator is a forward slash, okay, unlike Windows where it's a backslash, okay. So talk about symbolic things later. Now you get to the shell, the introduction of the shell. Now, what the shell is, now you wanna interact with the operating system, okay. Now, you're writing programs, you're running programs, but suppose you want to copy a bunch of files, or you want to read some files, or write some files. Delete some files. Okay, this is your regular. These are things you do on an operating system. So how do you interact with the Unix operating system? The Unix operating system provides the graphical interfaces just like Windows. Okay, where you can click and delete files. That's available. But there's an even more powerful way to interact with the Unix system. That's a shell. Okay, that's a text-based interface to the OS. Okay, it's text-based. Okay, all the commands are typed. Okay. And this is what we'll be discussing on the rest of the talk. So on the shell, you'll get something called a prompt. Okay. Most of the time when you boot into a Linux system, you'll get a graphical interface. Now suppose you want to access this shell, you would open the application called, it's usually called the terminal or the console. Okay, you open the console, and you will get something that looks like this. Okay. This is a prompt. Okay. It ends with a dollar sign. These are two prompts. Okay. This is a prompt when you're logged in as a normal user. So I've logged in as my name, and this is a prompt. And this is a prompt when you log in as a root user. So you can notice that for the root user, there's always a hash at the end. Okay, it tells you that you're on a root prompt. And if you have a dollar sign, that means you're on a user prompt. Okay, so it's kind of telling you that be careful. Okay, don't execute any rm remove delete command, because this is dangerous. So what this prompt tells you is that the shell is telling you, when the shell displays a prompt, what it's telling you is that it's ready to accept some commands. Okay? So commands are just words which you type on the keyboard and press enter. Okay? So the prompt tells you that, okay, I'm waiting for a command. You enter the command and it'll accept. So it's exactly the same as DOS, for those of you who used DOS before. But this is not exactly like DOS. So the bash, the shell in Linux is called bash. Okay, there are multiple shells available. So we're talking about the bash shell. Now this shell supports an entire, it's a language. Okay, so at the prompt, it actually supports an entire language. It's a programmable shell. Okay, so you can actually type some commands. You can write a small program over there, and it's going to perform those instructions. Okay, so normally on a DOS shell, you would type a command to delete a file, to remove a file. Okay, but the bash shell is programmable. So you can actually write a program. You can write that, okay, check if this file name is this, and if the file name is this, delete it. Okay? You can put conditions, you can put loops. Okay? It's completely programmable. Now, in the next session, we'll be teaching you how to program this, this shell. So right now, we just, before you program on the shell, you need to know the basics commands. The most frequent commands which you will be using to interact with the operating system. Okay. Now, one of the most common commands you'll be using on a Unix system is ls. Okay, ls means to list files. Okay, so the ls command, everybody knows, many of you already know ls command. The ls command lists the files in the current working directory. Okay, so what's the current working directory? Whenever you're on a shell at a prompt, okay, you have your prompt displaying. At that point, you are in a particular directory. Okay, that directory is called the current working directory. And if you want to know which directory you are in at this point, suppose you are at the shell prompt and you want to know which directory you are in, the current working directory, you would just type pwd. Okay, that says print working directory. You would type pwd and enter, and it would print the directory you are in. Now, if you type ls, what ls does is it's going to display all the files which are in the current working directory. Okay, so it's not going to display all the files in the entire file system. It's going to display the files which the current working directory you are in. It's going to display those files. Now, when you type the ls command, it's not going to really show all the files. Now, in Unix, if you have a file beginning with a dot character, okay, with a period, okay, that file is it's a hidden file. Okay, by hidden, it's not like it's hidden and you cannot access it. What it means is that it's not going to appear in your ls output. So suppose you have some files which contain some information you really don't want to, you don't want to access frequently, and you don't want that file to clutter your listing. So suppose you type ls and you have a bunch of, a long list of files, and you want some files to not appear in that list. Okay, you would just rename those files to begin with a dot. Okay, so period. And those files will not appear. Now most commands in Unix support options. Okay, so you specify an option like this. So ls space and a hyphen a. Okay, so this tells the ls command to print all files, to display all files, including the files which are hidden. Okay, so this is a command line option. We call this a command line option. Okay, or a command line parameter. Now, commands in Unix support short command line options and long command line options. So look at this command line option. Okay, so there's a little typo here. It's a double hyphen. Okay, so it's ls space double hyphen all. Okay, so this is a long option. This option is exactly the same as this option. Okay, so you have a long form and a short form. So long form is some word like it's usually an English word like all, which you can remember easily. Okay, and these are the traditional, like the original Unix options. Okay, they're shorter, but they're difficult to remember. So if you want to provide, so one program can have any number of options you can provide. So if you have short options, you can join them together. For example, there's the L option to ls. Okay, the L option tells ls to print not only the names of the files, but also details about the files, like the time it was created, and its size, okay, and its permissions. Okay, so the ls option is going to print that. So if you want to print all the files, including the details of the files, you will use ls-a-l. Okay? Now short options can be joined together. So you can just type ls-al. It's the same thing. Okay? But you cannot do this for long options. You can't join long options together. Okay? Now you can use any combination of long and short options in your program. Like I said earlier, you can join the short options. So this is the same as the earlier command. Okay? It prints all the files, including hidden files, and prints details of the files also. Okay. Now, sometimes many commands will have an option called hyphen hyphen help or hyphen h. When you pass this option to a program, to a command, it usually prints out a small summary of how to use that program. So, suppose you're new to Unix, okay, and you're using ls command, and you forgot some option. You need some option to sort the files according to their dates. Okay, you forgot the name of the option. You just type ls-h or ls-help, and it will print a short summary of all the options that it accepts. Then you would be able to find that the hyphen T option sorts files according to the modification dates. Okay? But suppose you needed more detailed information about a command. Okay, you want to know exactly what options do what. Okay, and if you want to see some examples of how a command is run, you would refer to a man page. Okay? So to access a man page is like a documentation for commands. Okay? It's like online documentation for commands. By online, I don't mean on the internet. It means that it's available on a computer. You don't have to refer to a book. Okay? So if you want to access the online documentation, the man page for the CP command, okay, copy command, you would type man space CP. Okay? So this brings up a page that looks like this. Okay? This is just the first few lines of that page. So it's going to be quite long. So this gives you detailed information about that command, what options it accepts, and what parameters you have to pass to that command. So this is the CP command. Okay, we tell man CP. CP is a copy command. So you can see in the first section there's a name. Okay, it's telling you a one-line summary of what the command does. Okay, so you're looking at a man page, and it tells that what does CP do? It copies files and directories. Okay, one-line summary of what the command does. Now you go down, it's going to show synopsis. Synopsis tells you how you're going to run that program, how you're going to run that command, how you're going to tell a CP which directories and which files to copy. Okay, so let's see here. Now, whenever you see something in all caps like this, okay, usually you see something in. Okay, in a man page, if you see something in all capitals, okay, or between angle brackets like this, okay, if you see something in angle brackets, what that means is that you have to substitute. So what that means, when you see something like this, what that means is that you need to substitute this with something else. Okay? So what it means is you need to substitute with the source file path name. Okay? So you're going to run the CP command, and you're going to tell the path name of the source file, and you're going to tell the path name of the destination file. So when you see something in all caps, that means you're not supposed to type it there exactly like that. You're not supposed to type source. You're supposed to type something in its place. That could be a keyword, or it could be a path name, or something else. Usually specified below. Okay, so it's, see in the description, copy source to dest. Okay, so source is your path name, and copies to dest. Now you will also find in the synopsis something like this. Okay, you find a hyphen T option. Okay, any option, but it's in between square brackets. Okay, so what does it mean when something is in between square brackets? It means that that option is optional. Okay, you do not need to specify it. So if you use CP with a source and destination, you can supply hyphen T option if you want to. Okay, if that hyphen T option will change the behavior of CP, but it's optional. Okay, so suppose dest was between square brackets. That means you can or cannot. If you don't want, you don't have to specify it. Okay, it's an optional parameter. Okay, so see these options, they're all in square brackets. That means if you want, you can run CP with just a source and a destination. You don't need to supply any options. Or you can supply these options which are listed below. Okay, now here you can find some dots here. Okay, those dots also have a meaning, this ellipsis. What does the ellipsis mean? When you have an ellipsis in a man page, it means that you can supply more than one of whatever that ellipsis follows. Okay, so here you have an ellipsis after source. That means you can specify more than one source file. Okay, so you can write CP, file 1, file 2, file 3, any number of files, and then the last one should be your directory. And it's going to copy all those files into that directory. Okay, so that's why the three dots. So you can see three dots here also. That means you can have more than one option. Okay, and see this last one. Okay, when you supply the hyphen small t option, it kind of reverses CP's, it reverses the source and directory. Okay, so you specify the destination first and then the source. Okay, then you pass the hyphen t option, small t. Okay, and here you can supply more than one source file. So that's how you read man pages. So most man pages for most commands will look something like this. Okay. There's one more thing I need to tell you. You might find options which are separated by a pipe symbol, okay, a bar. So you might find something like this. Okay. So what is a bracket tell you? The bracket tells you that it's an option. Optional. Okay. You can supply with hyphen T or hyphen S if you want. Okay. But what does this tell you, the bar? Okay, this tells you it's OR, okay? You can supply hyphen T or hyphen S, but not both. Okay, not both. So this is like mutual exclusion, okay? OR. It tells you that you can either give the S option or the T option. So it's not there in the CP command, but you'll find in other commands. Now a little bit about path names. Okay, so earlier I showed you how to specify the path, how to reach a file. So we're talking about path names here because you saw the CP command, it's asking for a source and a destination. How will you specify the source and destination? You'll be using path names. Okay? So what I showed you earlier is an absolute path name. Okay, an absolute path name always begins with a slash. Okay? So you have slash home slash file or something. Okay? This is an absolute path name. What it means is you're telling how to reach this file from the root. All the way from the root, you're giving the whole path to reach that file, okay? Now, there are things called relative path names. Now, suppose your file is very deep in this hierarchy, okay? Suppose your file is within many subdirectories, okay? It's going to be kind of difficult to specify the whole path, okay? Suppose you want to move a file, a copy of file from one directory in your home to another directory. You're going to write a huge absolute path name. So what these commands support a thing called relative path names. So what's a relative? You can notice a relative path name because it's not going to begin with a slash. Okay? Relative path name will not have a slash in the beginning. So relative path names are always, so what are they relative to? Okay? Relative path names are always relative to your current working directory. Okay? So if you type a relative path, it's going to start from your current working directory. So I'll show you this example, maybe make it clear. So the PWD, this dollar sign, where you see the dollar sign, that means I'm entering a command there. Okay? This is my prompt. Okay, I'm typing this command, and this is the output which you're going to get. Okay? So if you type the PWD command, you're going to get the current working directory. So this is my current working directory. Now CD documents, what does a CD command do? The CD command changes your current working directory. Okay? So I'm typing here CD documents. Now you can notice that this documents is a path name, but it doesn't begin with a slash. Okay, it's relative. What is it relative to? It's relative to home Ershaad. Okay. So when you type CD documents, and after you enter that command, when you check the working directory, it's gone to home Ershaad documents. Okay. So if you had to type this command using an absolute path name, it would look like this. Okay. You would have to type CD slash home slash Ershaad slash documents. You have to type the whole path. But since you're already inside, since your current working directory is already within Ershaad, you would just have to type this. Okay. Now again in Unix, something special about Unix. Every directory in Unix has two special subdirectories. Okay? Two subdirectories. You'll find it in any directory. Even if you create a new empty directory, it's going to have two subdirectories in it. Those two type subdirectories are the dot directory and the double dot directory. Okay, it's just dot and dot dot. So what do these directories do and why are they there? The dot directory is like a shortcut to your current working directory. So if you, for example, if you are using a CP command and the place of the source you put a dot, that dot means the current working directory. And if you put a dot dot, what does that mean? It means the parent of the current working directory. Suppose this is your current working directory, okay? Dot dot is the parent directory, it's slash, okay? It's parent directory slash. So see, look at this example. This is our present working directory, we're in the documents directory. We're using a relative path name here again for CD. We're using CD dot dot. What does that mean? Dot dot means the parent of the current working directory. So current working directory is documents, we're going to go to its parent, okay? So now the new present current working directory is okay, so dot dot and dot also are relative. The meanings of dot and dot depend on what your current working directory is. So they are also relative. So using the relative using relative path names in an example. We're going to use it for the CP command. Okay. So we're typing the PW command to know which what is our current working directory. It's home user one docs. Now suppose, what does this command do? CP, okay, you know, I don't know if you can see it in the back. It's CP dot dot slash img slash chart dot jpg space dot. Maybe this dot is not so visible in the back. Okay, so CP, this is a relative, you can know that there is a relative path name, there's no slash in the beginning, and there is also a relative one, just a dot. What this means is that it's going to copy, okay, it's going to go to the parent directory of your current working directory, and it's going to go to the img subdirectory in that parent directory, and the chart.jpg file. And where is it going to copy that file? It's going to copy it to dot. Dot is the current working directory. Okay? So suppose you had to write this using absolute path names. This is what it would look like. You would have to type cp slash home slash user1 slash img slash chart.jpg space slash home user1 slash dot. Okay? These two commands do exactly the same thing. Okay? But this one is relative to your current working directory. So you'll be using this a lot when you're working on Linux. Okay, so so the Unix, the power of the Unix command line comes from having a lot of commands. So the Unix design is such that you have a lot of small programs that do something very specific. For example, the CP command only copies files; it doesn't do anything else. Okay, so you don't have some. Very rarely in file you will find in Unix that you have some command that does a lot of things. Okay, like copies files and compresses them and stuff like that. You won't find that. You'll find a bunch of commands that do something very specific. Okay, this is some people call it the toolkit philosophy. Okay, it's like Unix is a toolkit. You have a bunch of small tools. Okay, and you use these tools together to do something useful. Now, in the shell scripting part, we'll be teaching you how to join these tools together and do really powerful things on the shell. But before that, this is the hard part. You need to remember the commands. Not all of them. You need to know some basic commands which you will be using. You need to know basic commands which you will be using while working on the shell. Okay, so there'll be a bunch of commands. I'll be telling you a brief summary about each one. Okay, so you know about the pwd command. Okay, what does the pwd command do? It prints the current working directory. The cd command changes your current working directory. Okay, so here we have a cd with an absolute path name. Here we have cd with a relative path name. Okay, the rm command. Okay, rm command is to delete a file. Okay, so if you write something like this, rm draft file dot txt, it's going to delete the draft file dot txt. Yeah.
You have to be in the root to do that.
You mean the root user or the root directory?
The root user. You have to be the root user to.
That depends. You mean rm?
Yeah,
it depends on whether that file, do you have permissions on that file. So suppose this file does not belong to you. Okay, suppose this file is not owned by you. Remember I told about users and groups? Suppose this file is owned by someone else and you try to delete it, it's not going to work. You're going to be returned an error. Okay, so if you want to remove a file, you need to have write permissions on that file. Okay, and by default, if you try to run rm on a directory, it's not going to delete a directory. RM deletes only files by default. But suppose you want to delete an entire directory which is having a large number of files in it, you would pass the RM-R command. Okay? The R, what does R mean? R is stands for recursive. What it means is going to go into, so temp direct, so I'm running the command RM-R temp there. It's going to go into this directory, delete all the files there, and then it's going to go into the subdirectories and delete the files there. It's going to do this continuously until all the files are deleted, and then finally it will remove this directory itself. Okay, so by default it doesn't delete directory, it just deletes individual files. Now if you look at the rm man page, you'll probably see a file dot dot dot, so you can give more than one file on rm. Okay, so you can delete three or any number of files in just one rm command. Okay, the cp command, you've already seen the man page for that. So this first CP command copies this file to another file. Okay, I'm making a copy of this file. The second CP command copies two directories. Okay, so this is a directory. Okay, if you did not give the hyphen R option and you gave CP and gave the name of two directories, it's not going to copy. Okay, so CP by default copies only individual files. So this is again the recursive option. What it does is you can make a copy of an entire directory. So suppose you have data, here's data dir. You give CP -r data dir copy. What it does is it creates a copy of that directory, including all the files in it, including all the subdirectories. Okay, entire copy. Now, there's an MV command. Okay, the MV command is for moving. Okay, you can move files and you can even rename them. Okay, so moving and renaming are same thing. So suppose you want to rename a file, okay, from old file name to new file name. This is a command that you would type at the prompt. Okay, you would type MV, old file name, new file name. Okay, rename the file. Now suppose you want to move a file from one directory to another. It's the same command, but you would, now this is a path name to the file, to, okay, here we're moving two directories, okay. So this is a path name to a directory called old dir, and this is a path name to a directory called new dir. So this doesn't exist. Okay, so you're gonna move, when you execute this command, what it's gonna do is it's gonna move this directory from old dir into backup directory. Okay, so old dir is a subdirectory of the user directory. Once this command is done, okay, old dir will be new dir will be a, it will be renamed to new dir, and new dir will be a subdirectory of backup. Okay.
What if the directory exists and some files are there in that?
If the directory existed, then this would become a subdirectory of new dir. Okay. Suppose new dir did not exist. Okay. You would get a new directory called new dir created there. Okay. And that would contain all the files that old dir had. Now suppose new dir already existed. There's a directory there with the same name. Okay. In that case, old dir would become a subdirectory of new dir.
But and here, both are same. Sorry. Both are having the same name. Still, that will be so. There, the user new dir is there. Suppose
there's already a directory called new dir.
Yeah. Then, if you copy, if you move,
you mean if this was new dir?
Hmm.
Yeah, it will become a subdirectory.
Subdirectory.
If as long as this exists, it's going to become a subdirectory.
Okay.
Right.
Can I directly replace a directory?
You want to overwrite another?
Yes.
You want to merge the files. So if you wanted to merge the files together, you would have to use the copy command. Okay, so you would copy all those files using the R option into that new directory. Command with relative path names. Okay, so we're copying this file to its parent directory. Okay, okay. So the mkdir command is when you want to create a directory. So if you execute a command like this, mkdir new dir, okay, it's going to create a directory where? Within your current working directory. Okay, so it's going to create a subdirectory in your current working directory.
This backup directory was created by mkdir in the home.
Yeah. You can, it should be there.
Yeah.
So if you do something like this, it's going to create a subdirectory within your current working directory. Now suppose you want to create a series of nested directories, okay? You want to create a directory and a subdirectory and a subdirectory within that in one go. You could use something like this. By default, mkdir is not going to create subdirectories. Okay? It's just going to create one directory within your current working directory. So if you give something like this, it's not going to create new dir and then new subdir within that. Okay? So you need to provide the P option. The P option will tell mkdir to create the parents before creating this. So before creating subdirectory, it's going to create new dir. Then it's going to create new subdirectory within that, okay, and then subdirectory is going to come within this one. Okay. So moving to the next command, the cat command. What the cat command does is, so if you type cat in a file name, what it's going to do is going to read that file and write the output. Okay, it's going to write the contents of that file to standard output. Okay, so standard output of cat. Now I said earlier that standard output is by default connected to your screen. Okay. So when you execute cat file1.txt, it's going to write the contents of that file onto the screen. It's just going to write it like that, print it on the screen. Now cat, actually the name comes from concatenate. So if you specify more than one file to the cat command, it's going to print all those files in sequence, okay, to your standard output. So it's going to print the contents of file 1 and the contents of file 2 without any separation. Okay, it's just going to dump the data out. Okay, So in your STD out, you'll be getting the contents of file 1 and file 2 continuously. Okay?
Is there a way you can put spaces by this command?
Yep.
I'm sorry? Is there a way you can within this command spaces so that you get to see the contents of the file separately?
Oh, within that? No, generally it's just going to write out the contents. Okay. So this is actually used for joining files together. Okay. So suppose you have a file which is split into two because you had to fit it on a floppy. Okay. So you have file 1 and file 2. Okay. Half of it on 1 and half on 2. What you would do if you want to join it? You would copy the first part onto your hard disk, you would copy the second one on hard disk. And if you want to join it together, you do cat file 1, file 2. And output it to a file. And then you get the whole again. So that's what is usually used for that kind of thing.
Yes, sir. I remember English, right? The word concatenate means exactly
that. Exactly that, yeah. Concatenate means
English word concatenate.
Okay, now the less command. The less command also is something you'll be using very frequently. Okay, the less command is like, it shows you the contents of the file, but it just, so if you use a cat command, it's just going to print the content of the file. And suppose your file is longer than one screen, okay? The top part is just going to go up, okay? You're just going to see one screen through. Now, suppose you want to see the file and you want to scroll through it, okay? You want to see the content of the file, you will use the less command. So less command is a pager, it's called a pager. What it does is it's going to show you the content of the file, but a page at a time. So you can use the down arrow, page down, page up, and you can scroll through the file and view it. So whenever you have files that you need to read on a command line that you want to see the contents of, you will use less and the file name. Now the next one is file. File is a command. Yeah.
This cannot be used like cat. I cannot use two files in this.
No, it wouldn't print it as one file. It will probably open both of them. Then you can switch between. Yeah, but it won't print it together. But there is a way you can. Okay, in the shell scripting part of the class, we'll be showing you how to compile cat and less together. Okay. So. The file command, so suppose you execute a command like this, file and some file name, it's going to tell you what that file is. So it means it's going to tell you whether the file is an image file, okay, whether it's a photograph, okay, whether it's a source file, a C source file, or whether it's executable. Okay. So what's so special about this command is that on Windows, how does the Windows system know whether it's looking at a file, a picture file, or an executable file? It looks at the extension. Okay? So picture file will have a .jpg extension and the executable will have .exe or .com or .bat or something like that, right? Okay? But file doesn't depend on your extension. Okay? So suppose this file is an image file which I took from a camera. Okay, and I rename the .jpg to something else, .data or something. Okay, or even .exe. And if you run the file command on it, it's going to say that this is an image file. Because file actually looks at the contents of a file. Okay, it looks at certain signatures within a file to determine what type of file it is. So file will tell you. So if you get a file which you can't recognize the extension, you would usually use this command first to find out what is inside. Okay. Now, how do you find files within your hierarchy? You have your hierarchy of the file system. You want to find files within it. Okay, the find command does exactly that. So,
probably here.
Sorry.
With this slide, can you start?
Okay. Yeah. So, the find command searches for files within your file system hierarchy. Okay. So, what are the? You would have to look at the man page for this, but this is the basic syntax. You have a find command, and you have a directory here. You need to tell which directory you want to start searching from. So, suppose you want to search from the top. Okay. You would put a slash over there. We put a slash over. Okay. Now we want to start from this source directory. Okay. So this is again a relative path name. Okay. So we want to start from source directory and search down from source. So all the subdirectories within source directory, we want to search for a particular file. So what file you want to search? You want to search for a file with the name, okay, *F9D. Okay. The star means those of you who use DOS. Okay. Star means it means anything. Okay, it means any, you can substitute star with any word. So what this command searches for, it searches for all files that end with the name .f9d. Okay, Okay, so that's what the star means. It means that anything dot F90. So this command is going to find all files and directories which end with dot F90, which are rooted below this source directory. So if there's some file above this, it's not going to find it. Okay. So we'll be telling you more about the star and other. These are called meta characters. We'll be telling you more about them in the shell scripting part. So don't worry about them right now.
But that has to be within double quotes.
Yeah. So we put it within double quotes so that the shell doesn't expand. I'll explain that in the next shell scripting. Okay. So the star is a special character that the shell interprets. Okay. So you need to put quotes here. So okay. And then there's another command, locate. Locate does the same thing as find, but little differently. Okay, locate also searches for a file. So you put locate and you type the name of the file you want to find. Okay. But locate is a lot faster. What locate does is that at particular intervals in your computer, the operating system is going to take an index, okay, of all the files in your entire file system. Okay. So it's going to go through all the files, all the directories, and store the names of all the files containing them on a huge index. Okay. And when you type locate some file name, it's going to search for that file name within the index. Okay, and if it's there, it's going to print the whole path, the absolute path to that file. Okay, so how is it different from find? Find doesn't use an index. Find actually goes through the file system and searches for a file. Okay, so the difference is that, suppose you created a file just now, okay, it's not going to be in the index, because the index is going to run only periodically, like maybe once in a day. Okay. So if you create a file recently, like today, okay, and you use the locate command, you're probably not going to find it there. It's not going to be able to find it because it's not in the index. So in those cases, you have to use the find directory. But if you're looking for some file which is probably indexed, okay, indexing usually runs once in a day on your computer, the locate will find it. Now, I told you about permissions earlier, about files, whether you have write permissions, read permissions on a file. Suppose you want to change the permissions on a file. Okay, suppose you want to restrict other people, other users from reading your file or writing to it. Okay, you would have to use the chmod command. Okay, chmod. So the syntax of chmod is the command, chmod command, and then a permissions, and then the file for which you want to change the permissions. So these permissions look something like this. Okay, it's got on the left side of the plus sign, you can either use a plus or minus, okay? So on the left is U. What does U mean? U means user. Okay? U stands for user. That means yourself, the owner of the file. So I am telling chmod to add the executable option to user. The user is me. Okay? I own this file. That's why I'm changing the option field. I'm making it executable. Okay? Plus means to add executable option. Okay? So making a file executable means you're telling the shell that this file contains some executable code. Okay? It can be run. Okay. So if a file does not have the executable permission set on it, you cannot run it. Okay, whether it's a program or a script, you cannot run it. So similar to U, you have other options. You have G and O. You have G and O. Okay. U stands for user, okay, the owner of the file. G stands for the group. Okay. Like I said earlier, every file belongs to one group. Okay, so you can tell permissions for that group. And O stands for everybody else. Okay, everybody else means everybody other than the user and the group. So suppose you wanted to remove write permissions to a particular file, okay? You wanted it such that everybody other than you, the owner, and the group to which the file belongs, cannot write to that file. Okay? Can write to that file. You will use something like this. Okay, chmod O plus W. That means everybody other than user and group gets write permissions plus W. If I put a minus W over there, that means I'm removing write permissions. That means anybody who doesn't belong to the group that file belongs to, or is not the owner of that file, cannot write to that file. And when you cannot write to file, you cannot delete it also. Okay? And this command, what it does is, and in one shot, I'm changing the permissions for the group and others. Okay? So I'm telling that remove, read, write, and execute permissions for this file from the group it belongs to, and everybody else. So that means the only person who can read this file is the user, the owner. Okay, so that's me. Since this file belongs to me, only the user can read this file. So I'm removing all three permissions. R stands for read, W stands for write, X stands for execute. So GO minus other dates means remove, read, write, and execute permissions for this file, for the group, and everybody else. Okay, so that's just a summary.
So to read the contents of a file like that, you have to be the root user in the prompt.
No. Again, if you own a file, you can do anything with it. If a file belongs to you, so every file belongs to a user and a group. Okay, every file is associated with one user ID and one group ID. So suppose you are logged into the system and there's a file which has your user ID on it. Okay, it's associated with your account. Okay, you can delete that file, you can view that file, and you can change the permissions on it. Okay, now suppose this file does not belong to you, then you cannot change the permissions on it. And unless the owner of that file has given you read permissions, you cannot read it. Now, about the root user. The root user can change permissions and read anybody's files. Okay? Everybody's files. Okay. So the permissions don't apply to root. So I think we're running out of time. So we'll end it here. There are a few more things we need to say, job control. And in the next class, we'll be telling you how to do multitasking on the command line. Okay, how to run many commands together. Okay, so the main Unix has been designed for multitasking from the ground up. Okay, ever since Unix was developed, it was designed for multitasking. So how do you do multitasking on the command line? We'll explain that next. And it also teaches the linear data.